Good morning, church. How is everyone today? I hope somebody got up to see this gorgeous sunrise this morning. It was absolutely beautiful. I was there. I know. I saw it. Welcome to Community Church of Davie. If you are watching us on Facebook, YouTube, or daviechurch.com, please like, share, and comment. It's a way for us to get our message out to the community. Before we get started, let us read together the vision statement of the church. Here at Community Church of Davie, God is transforming lives through sharing the promise and the hope of God's love. Amen. Amen. Any birthdays or anniversaries this week? No? We have the youngest church ever. Wow. Please remember to sign the attendance sheet on the little book on the pew so we have your attendance for being here today. Thank you. We appreciate that. WPP are extending an invitation to you for their upcoming revival on September 4th at 7 p.m. here in the sanctuary. WPP, Word, Prayer, and Praise. They share our sanctuary with us, and it would be wonderful if everybody could come out and support them. That is September 4th at 7 p.m. here in the sanctuary. Everyone is welcome. On Saturday, September 10th, from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m., there will be a back-to-school festival at Old Davie School. We're having a booth there. We're going to hand out information about the church, and the youth group will be doing a fundraiser by selling crafts. If you have anything you'd like to donate, or if anything you'd like to buy that you can't live without, we would love to have you come and visit. If you want more information, please check out online or call the office for more information. The church is looking for people interested in part-time position in the line of cleaning and handyman, etc. If you know anyone who might be interested in some part-time work, we would love to interview them. And also, there should be a little slip of paper in your bulletin. The little slip of paper is for the bell choir. We are looking for people who would like to participate in our bell choir. It's a wonderful opportunity and a beautiful ministry for this church. You do not have to be able to read music, which is wonderful because I can't, and I am looking forward to being in the bell choir because it's going to be fun. So please fill this out. Please put it in any one of the donation bowls at the beginning of the church on either side. We would love to have you try out. Also, if you are a singer and you would like to join us here on the chancel singers, we would love to have you try out for that as well. Thank you. If you're interested in going to the Emmaus Walks, the men's walk is September 29th through October 2nd. The women's walk is October 6th through October 9th. Please contact the office if you are interested in attending. It is an amazing experience. This coming Sunday is our first Communion Sunday. Our 24-hour prayer and fast starts on Saturday at noon and is broken on Sunday with communion. Please spend this time praying for God to give us the courage to invite our friends and neighbors to this church so that they may come into a life-changing relationship with God. We thank you, and it's time for our morning prayer, opening prayer. Oh, I'm sorry. I did want to mention that Katie would like to say something to you. If you pay attention, please.
Hello, good morning. I have some news to share with you. I have recently been diagnosed with cancer. So it's early prognosis. They say it looks good for surgery to get rid of it. So if over the next couple of months, I will be having that surgery, and there's a long recovery time. So I will be out for possibly up to 2 months. I will be gone next weekend visiting my family because my family wants to see me before the surgery. And I believe Pastor wants to speak as well.
So I would say I'll just extend a hand towards Catherine, and we're going to say a prayer over her. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for today, but we lift up to you your daughter, Catherine. We know that you love her, and she loves you, and you want goodness for her and her life. We ask you to anoint her with your spirit and to give her protection, this coming week as she travels home to see her family, but also protection through this process. We ask you to anoint the doctors and the nurses and the staff and all those that are involved in these procedures. We ask you to give them your wisdom and discernment that they make good decisions that bring healing and health into Catherine's life. We ask you to be present throughout this process and surround her with your love and the love of this congregation and of this church. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Please pray with me. Through the ages, O God, you have called us to follow. You led us to freedom, to hope, and peace. Enter our hearts again today and lead us to your healing love that we might serve you joyfully in this world that you have loaned us. Amen. Please stand as you are able as we sing a hymn of praise.
Thank you.
Please remain standing as you're able for the reading of the Word of God. Today's reading comes from 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. For many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you heard was coming and now is in the world already. Little children, you are from God and have overcome them. For he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. They are from the world. Therefore, they speak from the world, and the world listens to them. We are from God. Whoever knows God listens to us. Whoever is not from God does not listen to us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. May God bless this reading of his holy word. Please remain standing as you're able for the singing of the hymns.
Pray for one of the local churches. This week we are praying for Pastor Jasser Trujillo and Sabaoth Church. They meet here on the campus. Please pray for the pastor and the congregation to grow and for God to give them wisdom to help lead others to the Lord. Now let's go to God in prayer.
For some of us here today, Lord, we wish the summer would never end. We have enjoyed opportunities to travel, to relax, to break away from schedules and hectic calendars. For others, there is the thrill of entering the new season, looking forward to the challenges ahead. On this Sunday, we gather to receive your blessings once again, that we may recognize your presence in our lives and use the gifts that you have given us in service to others. As we have names and situations on our hearts, we offer to you in silent prayer for your compassionate healing, love. We add our names as well. Heal our wounds, we pray. Enable us to be strong in our commitment to you by serving others in need. Keep us open always to your abiding love. And now let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please rise as you are able, for the singing of the Glory Be to the Father.
Song, we like to respond musically, and so I'll replay the response for you, then the chancel singers will sing it for you, and then we invite you to join us.
Sweet lyre and the harp.
Blow the trumpet at the new moon, at the full moon, on our feast day.
For it is a statute for Israel, an ordinance. Oh, sorry.
For it is a statute for Israel, an ordinance of the God of Jacob, who made it a decree in Joseph when God went out over the land of Egypt.
Sing with joy to God, sing to God aloud, sing with joy to God, sing to God aloud.
I hear a voice I do not know.
I relieved your shoulder of the burden. Your hands were freed from the basket.
In distress you called, and I delivered you. I answered you in the secret place of thunder. I tested you at the waters of Meribah.
Hear, O my people, while I admonish you, O Israel, if you would but listen to me.
There shall be no strange god among you. You shall not bow down to a foreign god.
I am the Lord your God, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. Open wide your mouth, and I will fill it.
Sing with joy to God.
Thank you so much, Marty. That was beautiful. Please stand as you are able for the reading of the Word of God. This is from Matthew chapter 7, verses 15 through 20. Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will recognize them by their fruits. Are there grapes gathered from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? So every healthy tree bears good fruit, but the diseased tree bears bad fruit. A healthy tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor a diseased tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus you will recognize them by their fruits. May the Lord bless this reading of his holy word. You may be seated.
Let us pray. Gracious God, loving God, we ask you to be present in this moment. We ask you to send us your spirit so that we may feel your presence and that we may hear your words and listen, that we may obey you in all that we are called into. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, amen. So as we've been going through these sermons of John Wesley, of Jesus Christ's Sermon on the Mount, this is the second to last sermon of 13, and we are into the end of the Sermon on the Mount. This is the middle towards the end of chapter 7. And as we've been going through these sermons, we've been listening to John Wesley's words, and I pray learning a little bit more about John Wesley. And many of you know probably quite a bit about John Wesley, the founder of the Wesleyan Methodist movement back in the 1700s. Some of you may have heard of the Aldersgate experience, and that was the moment where John Wesley had an interaction with the Holy Spirit and felt that he had his conversion experience, as you would call it. The interesting thing is the date of that Aldersgate experience, which was in 1738. And I'm going to read you a little snippet of his own words about what happened on that evening. In the evening, I went very unwillingly to a society in Aldersgate Street where one was reading Martin Luther's preface to the Epistle to the Romans about a quarter before nine, while he was describing the change which God works in the heart through faith in Christ, I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt I did trust in Christ, Christ alone, for salvation, and an assurance was given me that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. So interestingly enough, that occurred in 1738. He was actually ordained as a minister back in 1728. So a decade after he became an ordained minister, he writes about having this conversion experience of having a personal connection through the Holy Spirit with God. Remember, he had already traveled to Georgia and had that failed mission experience in the 2 years he was here in America. This is obviously well after his time in college, when he was actually leading a small group where the name Methodist actually came about because they were so methodical in their study of Scripture and in trying to have connection with God that those outside the group maliciously called them Methodists, making fun of them. And John Wesley actually thought that the name, which was given to them in jest, was actually a perfect name for their group. And that's why we're called Methodists to this day. But it's interesting that John Wesley was an ordained preacher, teacher of the word, for a decade before he even admits that he had an experience where he believed he came into relationship with God. So the question probably might be going through your head, as it's gone through my mind, what was he doing all that time when he was preaching to different groups of people? What was he teaching them? And as we look at the scripture today, did he consider himself a false prophet or a false teacher through that time period? Interestingly enough, we are coming after the very fiery sermon from last week where John Wesley was aggressively talking about this narrow and wide path, and so I was preaching along those same lines, and some of you even may have been a little bit afraid or scared, and it is good to see you coming back after last week's sermon. I was wondering if I was going to be alone today after I scared all of you off. Some even called me a Southern Baptist, or they questioned whether or not I thought all of you were going to hell, and of course, I don't believe that. But I wanted to give you a little bit of a taste of the fiery words that John Wesley actually used in many of his sermons, including the one last week. And he starts this sermon off with, again, very fiery words and rhetoric, and he ends the sermon for this week in the same manner. But truthfully, during the most of the sermon, he actually has, even though these words from Jesus Christ, talking about wolves in sheep's clothing, prophets or false prophets, in a very negative light, he actually cautions us throughout the sermon to be careful about using these words in this scripture when we're talking about those that we are in disagreement, especially when we're talking about theological issues. We want to be careful about how we talk about other people and that we are slow to accuse them of being a false prophet. And even when we believe that they are acting as a false prophet, we need to be very careful about how we act towards them. Now, speaking of the fact that Wesley was giving a very fiery speech here in this sermon, he starts off very fiery as well, talking about the narrow and wide path. And remember, I am preaching to you, trying to describe and explain Wesley's sermon on Jesus Christ's words here in Matthew 5 through 7, the Sermon on the Mount. So a lot of what we're talking about is what John Wesley preached in this sermon. These are John Wesley's words, not necessarily my words. And so we want to understand that John Wesley starts his sermon being very plain, being very forceful, and directly to the point. First of all, prophet in this section of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, John Wesley explains Jesus is talking specifically about not people that are predicting the future, which sometimes we think of as a prophet, but here in this meaning, Jesus, according to John Wesley, is saying a prophet is someone who teaches or preaches about God and tries to explain to the people who God is and who are and how we're supposed to live in relationship with God. So John Wesley is talking about me, about your preachers, your teachers, your pastors, your reverends, especially in our modern context. He's directly speaking about your pastors and whether or not they're preaching falsely or preaching the word of God. Again, very directly, John Wesley says in his sermon, it's very easy. This conversation is very easy to understand. If your pastor is preaching the narrow path, then that is of God. And if your pastor is preaching the wide path, then that is a false prophet or a false teacher preacher. It's that simple. There is no in-between. If they teach you what is the narrow path, remember from last week, what are some of the signs of the wide path versus the narrow path? And we remember that very specifically John Wesley says, if it's popular, if there's a lot of people following, it's probably the wide path. If it's easy, it's probably the wide path. If the world is telling you to do it, if what your preacher's talking about and the world is talking about is very similar in nature, it's probably the wide path, and there's no argument here. Where does the wide path lead to? It leads you to, you all forgot already? It leads you to hell. And that's a literal hell. It's not a metaphor. It's a real place. And if you're on the wide path, that's where you're going. And I know a few of you got scared last week. I'm glad you're back, and please forgive me for being a little Southern Baptist last week. But that's how Wesley preached, and we see it again this week in this sermon. It's very simple. If your pastor, your preacher is preaching the wide path, then be afraid, be wary. You are probably dealing with a false prophet. Jesus then goes into these descriptions. We have these two very beautiful and vivid metaphors. The first is the wolf in sheep's clothing. John Wesley goes into this saying that even though it's only really one verse here, Jesus is using this in a way that's very important and actually tells us a lot. Again, this gives us some red flags or some clues to what a prophet, a false prophet, will look like. And the first is that they will seem harmless. They will rarely challenge you. They will be easy to follow and listen to because they won't say things that will scare you. So I guess last week at least I can check that box off that I scared you enough. That is what a false prophet would not do to you. They will not challenge or scare you or make you feel uncomfortable. They will also seem to be useful. They will seem to be like they have a purpose. They will also seem to be religious. And they will talk about, John Wesley, these are his words, and we send to you via email these sermons every week before the weekend so that you can read them yourselves. This is John Wesley's words. I'm not making this up. They will use love a lot. False prophets will rarely talk about sin and judgment and hell. They will talk about things that make you feel good, like love, often. They will, most importantly, preach to you about living what John Wesley would call a middle path journey or lifestyle. And part of that will be to tell you to be afraid of being too righteous. False prophets will tell you that too much righteousness, too much holiness is a bad thing. These are all signs of a wolf in sheep's clothing. Somebody who is preaching, teaching you this middle path, this path in between what God is calling you to and what the world calls you into. And John Wesley says, it's a lie. It's not a middle path. It's actually part of the wide path. And you're going, if you follow them, straight to hell. Now, Jesus then switches the metaphor over to this idea of how can you tell what is a false prophet? You can tell by their fruit. And we have this metaphor of the tree. Good trees produce good fruit. Bad trees produce bad fruit. And the bad tree, as we also see in John 15, where we're talking about the vineyard, the bad or the unconnected vines, the bad tree will be cut down and thrown into the fire. John Wesley says these words are obviously very powerful and instructive. The problem with the fruit sometimes is it takes a little while to see what the fruit is. We have to wait. We have to be patient. We have to see what is going to happen to find out what the fruit is. That's one of the issues with trying to figure out whether the fruit's good or the fruit's bad. By the time that we've waited, maybe we've gone too far and we've gotten ourselves into trouble. Well, John Wesley says there's some other ways to really find out about the fruit. One is to look at the person who is the preacher, the teacher. Look at their life. Look at, are they doing living that narrow path. And another thing for us to understand is, are they living the Beatitudes? Remember the Beatitudes that started this whole Sermon on the Mount off? The Beatitudes, the beginning of the sermon. So the Beatitudes become our mirror for trying to understand this whole situation, this whole issue. So going back to the Beatitudes, blessed are those that are poor in spirit. Blessed are those that are in mourning. Remember what those two were. And remember John Wesley said that we get these confused. We think that blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are the mourning, are those that have lost a loved one or have lost something very important in their life. But according to John Wesley, no. Blessed are the poor in spirit are those that know that they are sinful and broken from relationship with God, and they are in mourning because of that broken relationship, and they're in mourning for the whole world because the world is broken from relationship with God. So it's really this understanding that we are sinful, that we are broken, that we have fallen away from relationship with God, and that we need to repent for that relationship to be brought back into right relationship. Blessed are the meek and the merciful, those that respond to other people, even those they disagree with meekness and mercy, those that are pure of spirit, those that are the peacemakers, those that hunger and thirst for righteousness, and those that are persecuted for that same hunger and thirst, and persecuted for the sake of Jesus Christ. Those are all the Beatitudes. And so when we look at those, we can then look at our preachers, our teachers, our prophets, and say, are they living that out in their life? Are they striving for that transformation, for those Beatitudes in their own life? And the next is, are the people that are listening to them, the in this case, the congregation, the church, are the ones that are around that person, are they then therefore striving for those Beatitudes as well? Are they striving for righteousness and holiness? Are they striving to be meek and merciful? Are they striving to be the peacemakers? Are they striving to be persecuted for the sake of righteousness? These are all clues and hints for us to understand the fruit of the prophet. And if they are not doing that, then you are probably dealing with somebody that is not from God, but is from and representing the world. And so then, therefore, what and how do we react to that person who is acting in that false way? Do we just get up and walk away and reject, call out? Do we attack that person? John Wesley actually said no. As long as we can be around that person and not be convinced to travel the wide path, that we can stay on our narrow path, that we are actually called to, once again, John Wesley points back to the Beatitudes, to live the Beatitudes out in our relationship with them. Are we loving them with mercy and meekness? Do we want goodness for them? Do we want peace in the world, in our relationship? Are we living that out? The Beatitudes become our mirror in all of this, that we are called to use it to understand whether or not we're living out this narrow or wide path, that we don't need to attack them, that we should be treating them through the Beatitudes, but most importantly, we should do what? We should pray for them. We should be in prayer to God that God would reveal the narrow path and the wide path to us, that God will reveal the false prophets and the prophets from God to us, and that God will help us turn towards that, and if we are dealing with someone that is teaching falsely, that they would turn away from that as well. John Wesley concludes his sermon on this section in a very fiery exhortation to false prophets, begging them to turn away from their wide path teachings and lifestyle and to turn towards the narrow path, which will lead to salvation and truth. It's very forcefully done, and again, I would say go back and read Wesley's own words. You will see that he was absolutely a very fiery evangelical person who preached in probably a very different way than we see in most Methodist churches and places that we are used to in our modern context. That's where we need to be at right now. And this week, as we come into next Sunday, which is our Communion Sunday, every week here at Davie, we do something where we participate in a 24-hour fast. And it starts Saturday at noon. And what we ask you to do is eat lunch on Saturday and then skip all your snacking the rest of the afternoon and into the evening. And that night, skip dinner. Go to bed a little hungry, wake up on Sunday morning, skip breakfast, come to church, and break your fast with Holy Communion. And while you're doing that, we ask you, especially this week, to ask God, to pray to God intentionally, that God will show you this narrow path, this wide path, and where you're at on it, whether or not you're living the narrow path or not, and how you need to change. How do you need to be transformed by the Spirit to be willing to be on the narrow path? And also for our prophets, our teachers, our preachers, that we would teach and live that narrow path to you. And then if we're not, that we are transformed and changed because of the Spirit. Amen? Now, for whatever reason, for health issues or diet, you can't do fasting, that's perfectly okay. If you cannot fast, we would ask you to abstain. And what that means is abstain, give up something that the world tells you is very important, but that for God, you will give up for that same time period so that when you then come on Sunday and you break this fasting or abstaining time period, you do it through Holy Communion, and you come into a deep relationship focusing on God and giving God the glory through all of it so that we might truly live a narrow path to truth and salvation. Amen? Let us pray. Gracious God, we love you and we thank you. We thank you for this time and this opportunity that you've given us to strive to live into the righteousness that you're calling for us as individuals and as a people, as believers, in you and in all of what Jesus Christ did in his life, his ministry, his death, and his resurrection. In the name of Christ, our Lord and Savior, amen.
Thank you.
So as you go forth, there are plates at each exit. Those are for your tithes, your gifts, and your offerings. If you're watching online, please go to our website, daviechurchdat.com. There is a giving button about halfway down the homepage. We know that God will bless you through your giving. So as you go forth with God's blessing in your life, strive to live on the narrow path, to live it in all that you do. God bless you and go in peace. Amen.